so I thought maybe we could look at a portion of Dark City. You know, this film appeared the year before The Matrix. And as you'll see, Schreiber is included as a key mediating figure here, so much from his background in this film from our perspective, I think. Let's start with the prop. What are we being thrown into here? Science fiction. Yeah, just at the level of set design. This is future consistent. Like the Jetsons. Okay, there's that. But I would argue it looks like Metropolis. It looks like drawn out science fiction. Including the aliens being Nosferatu. The distinct German representation of the band. So, together with Daniel Paul Schreiber, we're thrown into a future place that's also a lab space, like simulacrum, or like one of the simulations in simulacrum. From this clip, we aren't given enough information, but what we did see is that the tuning is being used to keep changing the conditions of the experiment for the sake of future study. The human beings are under surveillance, and the surveillance is, or observation anyway, scientific observation, and the observation reaches a certain high point in this clip, when they try to use the memories, both the store of memories, but also potential combinations of memories that are themselves in part fictional. It's curious. But anyway, using memories, both real and fictional, as a more perfect way of tracking someone. What we don't know yet, but you would if you saw the whole film, is that the aliens are dying out, so they turn to humanity because they see humans as being psychically survivors, and so they're studying the humans that they have transported to Metropolis. It's actually a kind of island, for lack of a better word, in outer space. We're not really on Earth. And in this very controlled environment, they are trying to determine their own rescue via the human subjects. And yet at this point, at this crisis point, they discover that one of the humans is a mutation who can also tune. Means, of course, to live within a psychotic delusional system, in case you hadn't noticed. To be able to change everything by will alone. And that's the power of the aliens, Nosferatus, who immediately appoint Schreiber as their contact person and intermediary for the great experiment. How to understand human being from the perspective of psychosis, so that survival in the future, for the aliens at least, could become possible. So at that at this point, the experiment is revealed to be, or becomes, more psychoanalytic. Before, it seemed to be more of a sociological experiment, changing the class conditions and this, that, or the other over and over again. They don't seem to be getting anywhere. It's not until the crisis of mutation, which is the first opening, that they turn to the incorporation of memories in themselves within the observer as the new enabling condition for continuing the research. He's also, at the same time, a threat. Remember, this is, as they themselves know, as the aliens themselves acknowledge, a kind of doomed species that probably won't learn from this mutational opportunity. And they are at the same time trying to defend themselves against it. I'm not going to be able to finish our reading of the film right now. I just want to throw out the detail that might have been overlooked because it's not so clear in the long clip. But among the false experiences and memories that they have been injecting into the human subjects, and it's at that point that Murdoch begins to mutate, begins not to come under the control of the others' tuning, is a staging of serial murder scenes. So psychopathic violence is the content of scenes in which Murdoch's mutation is first triggered. So that's what German science fiction returns from outer space and turns to what is not necessarily the content or inoculation we associate with German science fiction proper, but a new topic carried over or carried forward or discovered. The content of psychopathic violence is at this point that something changes. And what might otherwise be a seemingly continuous transmission. Okay, let's have lunch.
Are there any female aliens? Because that might be.
Because we are going to lunch. But anyway. You left off with my quick indication that what accompanies the mutation of the protagonist, his increasing ability to tune, one of the triggers, one of the contents almost, is the scenario of slasher violence that the aliens seek to emplace him within. I added that as a connection to some of the things we've been saying, talking about, since from the look of things, as we said before, Dark City proposes a kind of recognizable return of German science fiction, pretty much in its German expressionist shape, arrives from outer space to subject human subjects to experimentation for the survival of the alien's own fit with technology. A fit which Dr. Schreber recognizes as a kind of psychotic fit, namely the ability to tune, the ability to hallucinate and create new orders or worlds at will. Okay, that was my reminder where we were at. Kind of already did, but no. we are inside a delusional system. We're in the lab. gap space with the aliens. We don't know it all the time. They do. So, if that's what your question meant, and I assume you didn't mean that the whole thing was symptomatic of that kind of analysis, but no, it makes pretty clear something that we've been considering and to the extent to which the new frontier of outer space comes to be synonymous with various attempts to understand, penetrate, perhaps even make habitable either psychosis itself or the border zone alongside the former limit concept, now something that's opening up.
Who was the character in the room that was having a psychotic vision where he almost had a breakdown?
So what has happened prior to the mutation of the protagonist is that on occasion there will be a glitch in tuning, a glitch in the experiment. This is what they thought Murdoch was. Murdoch was another example of it. First, on occasion someone will wake up in the middle of the experiment and find out too much, like the different contact persons who go mad in Simulacrum 3. So suddenly someone becomes a contact person, knows too much, and goes individually psychotic. That person will eventually witness a suicide. But that's an example of the mistakes that are made course of the experiment, and it's because of that, I suppose, that the mutation is allowed to develop. Because at first they're interested in these mistakes, the observers, until they get a little panicked about his ability to tune just as they can. But yes, he's a former police officer who has gone mad over knowing too much about the simulation. He knows that it's not his wife, remember. He knows that at the time of tuning, memories are exchanged, replaced. Even the people closest to you are suddenly replaced. So it's not a reality that he can recognize any longer. So he goes the way not of recovery, as in Schraber, as in the Schraber case, but the way of fade-out, explosion, suicide.
So is the idea then that the outside of psychosis is almost like a worse place than the inside of it?
Yeah, to the extent that inside and outside in this case could be applied to the very notion of the system. What Freud referred to as endopsychic perceptions coming out of delusions, they tend to be contained always by a system. Remember, Schraber comes up with a system of thought, which is coterminous with his notion of a new order of the world. Before that system could be established, or the new world order discovered. Remember, he was in the kind of chaotic state, chaotic state that is commemorated and included even as he stabilizes through the so-called bellowing miracles, those moments when he just has to lose it and scream. So yeah, that would be the inside-outside from our point of view. We have an operating system or world that is psychotic, and the one individual loses it on the sidelines of that establishment, as it were. And then we have Murdoch, who through something like mutation is able to enter the system as a tumor, precisely without losing it. I should say, since you haven't seen the whole film, that his tuning is such that he triumphs over the aliens. I'll just say this much, that it's not clear, I don't think, in the film what that means, to have triumphed over the aliens. But what he adds through his completely developed power is ocean to the insular status of this lab space and out of the universe. So now it becomes California.
On the topic that somebody raised about the gender of the devilish people, reminds me of Schreber's full inclusion into the psychotic delusion, where he also loses libido and he becomes kind of asexual. And perhaps this is a reason why there is a kind of latent asexuality to them, because they are inhabiting the psychotic delusion, so they lack libido. Is that possible?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Remember, in Freud's reading, not only is the one model is available for understanding the withdrawal of libido mourning, but even after the emergence of the New World Order, Freud points out that Schreber, in his memoirs, argues as he begins to recognize that the former world, even though he doesn't inhabit it, he feels, still exists. And even though he recognizes, as I mentioned before, that the cursory contraption people, the replicants, actually have their own kind of real existence that he has to acknowledge diplomatically. The world inside, internally, has changed, has been lost, he says at one point, which is something that Freud underscores. That's where he talks about there having been the loss of a wealth of sublimations even after a transfer to the New World Order. So, what that means, for example, is that sexualization that drove him to the crisis point, his control released in this mythico-psychotic arrangement he has with God, whereby regularly but very monumentally, with all kinds of interruptions I suppose built in, he does have a sexual life. He is God's consort, but it's no longer in the mode of surprise attack. He controls it to some extent. That's the result of his having learned how to tune to. Whatever sexuality survives the loss of the world, it is running on, I don't want to say empty, but running on a kind of depletion. That loss of the former world and the former sublimations that make that former world possible. Possibly sexual. So, these Nosferatu figures from outer space also seem to be running on some sort of depleted water sprinkler of libido. However, that we don't see them in their pairing situations. Remember, also means that we don't see them in all the corners of their existence. These are the mad scientists of the alien species at the control panels of the experiment. At least I was never, I never thought that this was the entire folk, as it were, gathered together to tune as one. That it's more of a group than the entire mass of the alien species. Anyway, these are the figures who are running lab and the experiment. There's a child there too. I don't know, did we see that in the...
Yeah, we saw the child.
So something's going on. They're not all the same age all at once. And the ending that takes us to California, as it were, is also a kind of lame ending, which I think is part of the complete homage to Metropolis, where the lame ending is also historically unique and significant, something that most people know about if they know anything about that film. But there's a difference here, and it's the contribution of the film. There are other contributions. Or let's put it this way, the film in many ways confirms some of the stuff we've been talking about, but at one point, it doesn't necessarily make a point completely new to us, but it does surprise me anyway that this moment is included. And that is the moment of Shell Beach. I think there are only two instances of its recollection. What would you say about how that functions in this film, Shell Beach? The two examples are far enough apart that we could have noticed something about Shell Beach.
You just mean from the memories, like when it's flashing back, like that like scene, you mean? Or is it a point of the end at that point, that's like injected that it exists?
Right, but I think it happens three times. Yeah, but also in that injection scene. He asks the cab driver about it, I think. Mm-hmm. There might be one more.
Yeah. In the first instance, at least with the cab driver, like, it seems like it kind of functions as a marker of external reality. It's like this maybe even sort of reality testing of a cab driver, you know, spent one of his most important moments of his life there and can't remember which street it is that he takes to get there. So it's sort of this gap that kind of opens up the possibility.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's like a touchstone. It's almost like he's, you know, there is some sort of nightmare, but Shell Beach represents the reality. Can't quite access it. Like, it's interesting how the cab driver does absolutely recognize it, but then when it comes down to it, doesn't quite know how to get there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm interested. This is kind of not an answer, but maybe an opening. Interested in how memory functions as a signifier for humanness, and here the creatures, whatever they are. It's kind of investigative when they insert his memory, but it does indicate a power of humanity, and I think something's happening there with Shell Beach. And I know it's a trope, but it's also reminds me of Blade Runner, and Rachel believes she's human because she has memories.
Right.
And when you take away those memories, you're no longer human. Or when you add those memories, potentially you're getting to a humanness, and therefore there's a fine line.
But in the case of Blade Runner, now the film, not the movie it's based on, the film ends up saying something about human memory, too, really along psychoanalytic lines. Because according to psychoanalysis, we don't remember a whole lot that's real. We have to work through a relay of screen memories, if we're that motivated, so-called screen memories, to get to something primal. So within the context of psychic mechanisms and the psychic apparatus, all of which already sounds by analogy like machinery, the connection between the human and the robot in that particular film comes to be surprisingly underscored. In this film, as you said, they stumble. They instrumentalize memories. Again, it's sort of a sociological understanding of memory. It's only when they risk injecting themselves with memory, which is fatal for them. So the guy who injects himself for the alien species to track Murdoch knows that he's going to give up his life and doing this. because as we saw in the jumble, which the film techniques tried to get across to us, that it's the chaos of memory that they can't really control, release, or that they try to, let's say, but it's what they can't really control, and it's deadly when absorbed by their system. But even in that jumble of memory, we know some of it's false, and Shell Beach is there too. I mean, there's a contradiction here. If memory in the experimental situation is that manipulable, that interchangeable, we saw how one lower middle class or working class family is suddenly transformed utterly into an upper class family with different accents and with different memories too. That means that everything is cut adrift in this working through with of memory. The experiment reaches its ultimate pitch when the observers too inject themselves with these memory solutions. But given that absolute flux of souvenirs, how is it possible that Shell Beach should be extended throughout the film? Again, you didn't see this in the clip, but it came up, I think, three times, even before and after attuning. And throughout the film, everyone has the taxi driver's relationship to Shell Beach. It's something he knows absolutely, but then can't quite identify. It's like a moment in a dream that Freud advises in the Essay on the Uncanny invites him at least to interpret this moment of recognition but not identification as a representation and repression of the mother's body, the relationship to the mother. But I don't want to go there right now, actually. Or maybe I am after all, but the structure interests me. And it's the cab driver's relationship to the memory that is the structure throughout the film. It's fetishism, right? Shell Beach is the fetish that organizes Dark City. I don't know where that organization comes from. Perhaps it doesn't matter. It's stowaway in the alien injections, apparently. But what it means that it's a fetish is quite simply that it takes everyone to the border of something that can't be remembered fully. It's kind of the group traumatic amnesia. All these people were dislocated, brought to this space and space. And what holds the fictive metropolis-like environment together is only Shell Beach. Shell Beach that then gets a kind of floating ocean alongside it. So for the first time, there is something like a beach, but it's still an artifact, a construct. It's one concession to trauma as a structure that outlasts psychic or technological manipulations of memory itself. What makes this group of humans human within this film is the fetishistic relationship to trauma.
Frankfurt for 3 times, and is, you mean, so the objects themselves are the Pedersen it relates to, shall be, so it's like the little snow globe, and then later the, like, the journal that he goes back to find?
Sure. There is a long relay of those objects that I'd say the very idea of Sheldon is what keeps on coming up in different manifestations. As some place on a map that everyone believes in, that orients everyone, not to a point that is desire-filled, but yet can't be fully reached for good reason. I mean, that's where they all live and survive, is in Shell Beach.
It reminds me of almost every garden in post-war Germany, the kind of fetishization of almost everything you see in a Heimat film of the 50s through the 70s. I've been thinking about that through this entire class, and that snow globe is, for me, up until, I mean, even up to today, but especially from the 50s through the 70s.
And those gardens are Schrever gardens.
Yeah.
Stan Douglas, a really great video installation. You can see it as a video, unfortunately not as an installation on the internet, but it's called The Sandman. And he staged it in Potsdam specifically, and explicitly said over and again in a Schreber garden. So, an example of an art installation, but also refers to some of our topics. Switch to the simulacra, see where that takes us. Something that I think is compatible with the simulacra is Godard's film Alphaville, that we may see a clip from. The first I want to think about simulacra would be. Of course, this is a limited edition. I didn't know when I planned the seminar on short notice that I'd be giving the paper as well. I kind of gave my reading and so on. But anyway, one way to think about the simulacra in the complete setting of science fiction or sci-fi might be to begin again with something that Gotthard Günther wrote. Gotthard Günther was a Hegelian philosopher who was one of the German founders of cybernetics. And he spent the war years with his Jewish wife in the United States. And while there was contacted by one science fiction magazine in particular, Startling Stories, and asked to write a series of essays about the philosophy and the science inside science fiction. Most of those articles can be found online. I recommend them to you. When he went back to Germany, then after the war, he continued that line of inquiry in the form of prefaces to science fiction, story collections, and so on. That was a recommendation, but what I want to recall now is his topography of science fiction. He begins by saying that civilization comes from the East so emphatically that the whole notion of westward exploration tends to be naively received as the history of a kind of progress or even of desire. It says that the westward momentum that led to the discovery of the New World occurred through a kind of mistake anyway. Columbus didn't know where he landed. But was also really only confirmed after the discovery had already been made several times without one's knowing it. So he argues that this new world that can't be recognized by the center of civilization, a center that is a fixed place, fixed in place and time, through traditions, through the mother tongue, through all sorts of grounding mechanisms, that what the East could not recognize in the New World was rehearsed, in a sense, by various contacts with so-called primitive civilization, a series of contacts that would be the placeholder for a more global order. Because wherever you go, wherever the Europeans went to encounter so-called primitive culture, they always found the same culture, pretty much animistic, kind of occasion for theorizing human activity, relationality, without the burdens and fixity of civilized tradition. And so he argues that the exceptional place of so-called primitive culture is extended and expanded and realized or fulfilled in the New World. Only in relation to this New World is science fiction possible, he argues. Only in relation, pro or con. I should add quickly that Metropolis, for example, is a reaction on Lang's part to a visit to New York City. Only in relation to the New World that one was able to imagine a robotic alignment of consciousness in which self or form and content contained each other as a unit, say. From where civilization comes in this argument, from the East, the closest one ever came to such a possibility was the Golem legend. But the the multiplication of robotic existence as a kind of model for understanding human consciousness requires a certain emptiness, as it were, a certain exclusion of the traditional in order to be thought. So in other words, the extension, this is the only way that the New World is the extent, finds itself extended as outer space in science fiction. It's not because he says that the New World represented a kind of aggrandizement of European interests, for example, that could then be conceivably extended into outer space. But once we are in this no longer exceptional place of the primitive, of the global, only at that point could one begin to recognize outer space as the new frontier, and maybe psychosis at the same time. By that I would want to remind you that Freud gets to his reading of Schreber at the same time as his as Totem and Taboo via his study of the first findings of the brand new science of anthropology. People are today are turned off, of course, by the nature of that of those findings, but Freud really just took it as it was, and that take I think refers to this burgeoning discovery of the primitive, a discovery that leads in Freud's case to the ability to think interchangeably childhood, neuroticism itself, going on psychosis, and the so-called global stripped-down lab space kind of example of the human. So the lab space we see projected, the lab space we find projected in Dark City, ultimately, if we're going to follow this reading, comes out of these many rehearsals over and against the so-called primitive that spread out and became foundational once the West happened to us. Yeah?
In your definition of the East, are you defining the East as the continent, and then the West became the new world?
Kind of, yeah. That's what, that's my understanding of what he means. Europe, but not just Europe, of course, because that all came from India and what have you. So the oldest civilizations. But Europe was not the new world to those civilizations, you would probably be arguing. So, what this also means is that the, I'm sorry.
What was his name? I didn't.
Perfectly willing to use an American pronunciation with German names, but this would not benefit from that. So the reason I suggested that this was kind of an introduction leading to the simulacra, but not just the simulacra, is to give more than an appreciation of what seems to be something like a fact, that at the west, at a certain western extreme of this westward movement, in something that becomes recognizable as California in Dick's work, we're in a place that has the vacuity or vitality, or it has something that allows it to sustain the most turbulent experiments imaginable. And so it's at this outer limit westward expansion of the primitive or the global that we're able to contemplate after the war of the cohabitation of California and Germany. It's a Germany that is it's West Germany. But the experiment also requires various kinds of contact with the psychopath and traumatic, depending upon your position, past. It belongs to the immediate or immediate prehistory of this origin. Let me say something else as a kind of introduction, and that is that Adorno, in his correspondence with Benjamin about the Passage in Bach, the Arcades Project, says something very interesting at one point. I'm not one to dismiss Adorno, even in this exchange, though he was really cruel to Benjamin. The cruelty of a fan, a very smart fan, an unforgiving best student, because he's always reminding Benjamin of Benjamin's own work, which is what a good student does. Please remember our origin of the German mourning play. You're losing it here in your discussion. Contemporary culture industry. And at this point of remembering, Adorno says something that I found very inspiring. He says, the recent past is the most repressed period of time. The recent past, of course, means the recent past, the recognizable past, the one that we can still identify with, populate, close up recollections and so on, but it also means that moment of the present turning into the recent past, that span of time is the most repressed, and that it tends, therefore, because everything that's repressed is in the ready position to return, it tends, therefore, to return in the mode of catastrophic, of a catastrophic effect. So, what California has to have the strength for also involves, in this perhaps larger sense, what is already volatile, the recent past itself. The recent past, I would have to argue, is where the dead are. It's one of the reasons why it's the most repressed. And it's this time zone that is fully assembled or reassembled in Usia, the fictional world of the simulacra. Okay, having said that, let's look at how the simulacra or the robots are used here. Alongside the secret mascot status that they supply, namely the simulation of the arte, the seemingly, ostensibly ruling figure, alongside the First Lady. Robots are otherwise in use in circulation as means of a kind of therapeutic support for people otherwise overexposed to isolation, notably as colonists on Mars, for example. So robots are used to simulate neighborhoods, neighbors, some kind of recognizable context, precisely to push back psychoticization. So they are employed along those lines. Now, in this particular book, we have simulacra or androids and other works by Dick, as you know, But in this particular one, what we have to add to all of the above is that the Third Reich continues to hover on the horizon as that which also has to be pushed back, even as one can't help but relate to it. Because the warning is issued at one point, and remember, anything in time is available, theoretically, because of the introduction of time travel. But we're warned by various figures in the novel that it is not advisable, sometimes it's put more strongly, to go anywhere near the Third Reich, because it is a kind of hub of psychosis that is could be a source of contamination. So the robots are part of a defense system over and against the prospect of psychoticization, which takes the historical form, historical and extreme form of the Third Reich itself. So the G's, with their secret knowledge, could be said to hold the position of Dr. Schreiber in Dark City, that double position. Oh, I forgot to mention, if and when you see the complete film, or see it again, Dr. Schreiber, the last minute, sides with Murdoch through a form of subterfuge, so it's through their alliance, actually, that Murdoch is in a position to overthrow the aliens completely. In any event, here, the G's have that initial double position. They mediate, as Dr. Schreiber does in Dark City. They mediate the shocks of history as shots of inoculation against the impact of annihilation. They are shots of towards the end, the hierarchy of G's and B's is overthrown, we are confronted with the emergence of psychopathic violence as, I leave this up to you what to do with it, but as explicitly politics. Up to a certain point, it becomes clear that this heavily therapeutic, robotic, administered society called Usia is basically trying to control all kinds of psychopathic violence, all kinds of ruthless violence, even in the past. One could almost say that containing that violence is its sole content, it's its only organizing purpose, much like keeping Metropolis alive and animated and projected seems to be the only purpose of the techno underworld of that film, but it's in the figure of Combrosian, who's the identified psychotic in this big novel. It's in his person that psychopathy is staged as the problem that breaks out. He's a star within the culture industry of UCO, a rather diminished culture industry that consists in the main of tryouts and amateur hours in every co-op. Almost nightly basis. Those shows are then selected for a performance at the White House, which in turn is broadcast as television. That's really the short circuit of culture and UCO. Grossian is considered to be the exception. He plays classical music, but he does so psychokinetically, mainly without his hands. So he is a medium who wields psychokinetic powers. And if you know Philip K. Dick's work, that puts him within a certain cult guild with the telepaths and the precogs and all the rest. And like those in Dick's work, Grossian, through his psychokinetic powers, he's also a psychotic, but has also psychokinetic powers, is referred to as the acausal element in any kind of scheme or narrative that is going down at this moment in UCL. Because there are political intrigues that are being formulated, but they come to a head and are, in a sense, undone at the very moment that this kind of ruthless violence breaks out. And it breaks out in the first place when Grossian, offered drug treatment, discovers that outside of the concert setting, he can also manipulate bodies. He throws the psychopharmacologist by will alone, by tuning, out the window or whatever. And later on in a subsequent scene, he figures that he can also remove vital organs from bodies. So he becomes this weird psychokinetic, psycho killer. And the main figure in charge of the political plan to take over government is the one who first says, "Have you used your powers politically before?" And he reclaims that notion as fitting. So this is the double advent in the novel, curiously enough. In an environment that has been so constrained in the attempt to control all kinds of ruthless violence, it is this double outbreak of politics and the violence itself that we encounter at the end of the novel. Not as the end. That outbreak issues in the Civil War, which Dick refers to here as everywhere else Civil War erupts in his fictional order, refers to as the war that is always a loss. No one wins a Civil War. It's, for him, it's the figure of unmitigated loss. And as that erupts, however, because no discrete takeover has succeeded within that massively destructive impasse of Civil War, we go to Grossian's home, away from the various capital cities, off in Jenner, California, where he lives in a kind of radiation-spawned rainforest, wife and child. And the child, who is referred to several times in the course of the novel, and you sense that it's another geheimness, another secret that's being carried, as it were, in the novel. Grossian touches upon it at one juncture and then realizes it's more like a catastrophic slip. He says when the talent agent from the White House asks him, can't he get over his current psychotic outbreak so that he can come to the White House and perform, he says that, well, I'm too ill right now, why don't I send my son instead? He almost says it, and then he comments to himself that that is the most insane thought that ever crossed his mind. So we know it's loaded, but then we discover that his son is a so-called chupper, which is the term applied to not a radiation freak, but a missing link, really. Sort of a return of the Neanderthal stream in prehistory, which can return because it was included in our development, as it were, through intermarriage. Anyway, that's speculated at some point. The earlier strain, the missing link, has been carried forward, and at around this time, the time of the formation of Usia, begins to release the so-called jumpers. That's how the novel then ends, that the Neanderthal strain appears to be recognizing this outbreak of destruction as the outside chance for their arrival, as it were, for their being able to come out of their seclusion. For their integration, as it were, the integration of the missing link. So if you look at the relay of fantasy components or elements in the novel, everything that happens, which happens to contain, somehow integrate, control, release violence and its history, a certain kind of violence, and the history of that violence, in the end, what is carried forward in spite of or through the accumulating violence is this secreted away new species, this secreted away new generation, this secreted away form of connection with the future. So it's what can't be. It's what can't be secreted away. You could carry the secret and lose it of the robot or the first lady. There were a great many secrets that were simply carried for the time being. And there's even talk of the relationship between the bees and the G's as being kind of developmental. Bees are often initiated into G status. But when that all falls away, we encounter an ultimate secret that even though it is disclosed to us, becomes kind of the secret ending or secret beginning at this ending of the novel, or otherwise dominated by civil war as the scene of losses. Okay, so I want to consider with you the role of alternate history in all of this. It's not so foregrounded in this particular novel, but I think you're all familiar with the technique or the fantasy. Here it's implicit in time travel itself, I suppose, because every time trip becomes something like an alternate reality. But in other fictions, it's more sustained. And this brings us to a closer understanding of science fiction in Philip K. Dick. The strange, secreted away conclusion of the novel The Simulacra occupies a place that is associated with fantasy, in the sense of the fantasy genre. So when the music recording people and so on first go to Jenner, because they wanted to record Grossian's piano playing, and in his absence they discovered the Juppers instead and want to record their sounds. They're always referring to this place in fantasy terms. Trolls are mentioned, and so on and so forth. This happens a lot in Dick. There's another novel, I can't remember which one it is right now, where various mutants that were raised as mutants, and they would be able to survive without too much technical apparatus on Venus. Once they get to Venus and establish their colony, they start creating a second Hobbitsville or whatever. We're suddenly in the Lord of the Rings with these figures. It appears, the reference, as it were, to the fantasy genre comes up often at the untenable place of a conclusion, a non-conclusion. Really is this foreign body that's being metabolized in some sense. Dick began, he recalls, wanting to write fantasy fiction, and then decided against it and pursued science fiction instead, for the following reasons that he recollected in numerous interviews. But there's one interview that I can recall in which he says the difference between fantasy and science fiction is that in fantasy, and this is compatible with what Tolkien also says about the fantasy genre in his essay on fairy stories, that in fantasy we visit a realm of elves or trolls or what have you, but then when we return from that visit, we most likely don't take any of that with us. It remains a separate place, and that separateness through Christianity, or through the belief in Christianity, is the placeholder then for the one time fantasy merges with life, namely at that moment of death, when the ultimate fantasy proves to be true, namely the fantasy of the death of death. So, the relationship of the fantasy genre to the world, that's the right word right now, is activated only in death under the aegis of Christian belief. I mean, that's the complete argument that Tolkien gives. Dick's point is simply that it remains, in this particular interview I'm thinking of, it remains in a separate place, in its placeholder. Whereas with science fiction, every time we enter a science fiction or project one, it's a possible reality. It's a possible world. And is already an alternate world. It doesn't go away in that sense. Or we don't go away from it. Or we will be in that sense. So it's that relationship to science fiction, which he formulated, remember, in contrast to his deepest desire to engage in the Christian genre of fantasy. It's this immediate recognition of the difference that science fiction holds that already introduces this particular practice of alternate reality, alternate history. At some other juncture, in another interview I remember, he says, when he's asked about his use of alternate, sometimes it's called alternate history, parallel history, it's alternate reality. He says that unlike other authors, he's not interested in an alternate past. He's only interested in an alternate present. That's important. Because that changes everything. An alternate present means that at one time, finitude is expanded without being exchanged for something like eternity. It's a radically secular affirmation of the recording surface of remembrance. That it's a radically, and I think in sync with Benjamin too, because I'm ultimately talking about allegory, but it's a radically secular affirmation of finitude, which can thus be extended to some extent as recording surface for remembrance. So the only thing that exceeds finitude, of course, is remembrance itself. And that remembrance can undergo a certain extension, which is not perhaps indefinite, through the introduction of an alternate present. If you remember some other fictions like Varus, you'll see that the tendency for him is to use this structure to remain within the recent past. The recent past before, it's his medium or span of time. For all the complicated technology that it might require in the second novel in the Ballast trilogy, which is called, in any event, in that one, for example, just remembering that it happens there, through various media technologies that are amped up for the future, the protagonist is able to remain in touch with the relatively recently departed, and is able, in fact, to visit them. They're all on tape, on record, in some kind of way in which he can continue to be with them and communicate with them. This reaches its apex in Ubik, where the dead don't simply die, but for an extended period of time, which however is finite, are available for communication in these techno-moratoriums that are the realization, in a sense, the techno-realization of spiritualism. It was when Freud was thinking about some of these structures over and against the lab space of primitive or global culture and taboo, that he borrowed the notion of two deaths. Psychoanalysis outside of this discovery would tend to count two deaths anyway, but would begin counting with castration. Castration is the first step, or initiation into some kind of relationship to death, that is then seconded by every other contact with death. Every contact with loss is that second death. But instead, Freud discovered that the first death is the death itself, and the second death would be that moment when even remembrance no longer holds up. So he refers to so-called primitive rituals whereby after the first death and burial, everyone lives with the remembrance or ghost of the departed as though still in their midst. To have contact, especially at night, with this ghostly remembrance has all kinds of consequences. And then after roughly 2 years, the mourners reconvene, open up the grave, take out the decayed remains, and establish the second death that is over. And this span between first and second death would be another way also to think about what the recent past holds and what Dick explores and inhabits in some of these science fictions. It's realized in particular in Ubik. But I think characterizes in general the way in which he extends and interprets the notion of remembrance itself. Now, in the simulacra, as we saw, time travel goes much further in time. In some sense, the Third Reich will always be part of recent history, of course. But notice that in that